Jane, everybody. I'm Brendan O'Brien.
And I'm Rena Ezra.
And we got a great guest for you today. It's actually, I think it's our first edibles creator that we've had on the podcast, right?
Ooh, perhaps.
Yes, I think so. Mm-hmm. So it's a great honor for us to have on Gabby. Thank you for being here, Gabby.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. Yes, and we honestly, like, we just hit record because, like, Gabby was starting to give us some, like, real good info, some good stories, and some good insight into the life that she lives, and we, like, couldn't waste another second not getting that for you guys. So thank you guys for listening to us, and thank you for being here today, Gabby.
Awesome. I am super excited.
Where are you coming from today?
North Arlington.
Okay.
So not too far, but
pretty close. Yeah.
A lot of traffic today. Not sure what's going on.
That traffic. I always wonder if it is already the holiday season.
Yeah.
You know, it's traffic because of, like, classic people leaving work or there was whatever, it's rush hour. But then just, like, there are longer lines at, you know, Kohl's and Lee's UPS store when you return Amazon shipments now.
Oh,
there's stuff like, it's November. It's hitting.
And especially now that with, like, daylight saving, that it's darker.
Yeah.
People's internal clocks have not adjusted yet. So once, like, the other day it was, like, 5 o'clock and I'm like, is it, like, midnight? Like, what is this? But I feel like with it getting darker now, people just can't drive. Like, the moment, like, you lose daylight, you lose your sense of direction.
Yeah, I mean, New Jersey drivers were not the best to begin with.
And then you turn the lights off, and then you're just asking in trouble at that point.
But yeah, I feel like also during the pandemic, I've been noticing it it gets way worse.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's just me, but I'm, like, more terrified on the road now.
Oh, yeah, I don't drive
I don't even
night.
Have a car. I don't drive that much, but being in the passenger seat, I'm
I
just
hate,
like,
driving at night. But it's funny, because during the pandemic, for, like, 6 months, I did not change my headlights. They were both out. And that was my excuse to not drive at night. Exactly.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, can't go out at night, but I don't have headlights.
I think that's a very clever restriction. You
put
on yourself. Dangerous, but
Years ago, I had a similar thing where at one point I was driving up. Actually, I was driving up to I would have been breaking up with my girlfriend at the time, and I ended up not getting up there. And I was like, oh, I guess this is a sign, because my windshield wipers, like, stopped working in the middle of driving up there. And then I spent, like, 6 or 7 months with no windshield wipers. And I was like, all right, if it rains, I guess I had to
go
outside.
Yo, that
I didn't want it anyway. So,
oh my god,
it's like,
but you gotta keep
back in the day. It's like, once the street lights come on, you gotta get home.
Yeah.
But it's because I don't have headlights.
Wow, that's oh my gosh.
Yeah.
All right. Well, before we go into the wonderful Gabby's Gourmet Goodies,
mm-hmm.
that's recently become an LLC.
Yeah.
Congrats. We have to give you your challenge.
Yes. Okay. So you are going to receive a challenge throughout the duration of the podcast. It's no pressure. It's just whenever you want to say anything that is on a list that we're going to give you, you just shout them out. If it's in the middle of conversation, you just say an item on this list. And the challenge that you have is to name as many capital cities in the United States as you can.
Oh, I'm so fun.
Listen.
Can I curse?
Oh, you can say.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Have you not done that yet already? I feel like quite often.
Guys, in case you're wondering if this is one of those cursing podcasts, you're fucking right. Most of the sessions are fucking Mary Jane.
How do you pronounce your last name? Perim?
Perim.
Mm.
Oh, okay. Awesome.
Yes.
Gabriela Perim.
Yes. And you said that your family, you're from Brazil?
Yes.
Yes. Cool. What part of Brazil?
Minas.
Okay.
Minas Gerais.
Cool. And are you from there too, or are you?
I was born here, but my whole family is from there.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm definitely Brazilian.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to be going back for the first time in 16 years this January. So I'm super excited.
Ooh.
Yeah. So this is the first time I'll be going there when it's the Brazilian summer. And I'm also going to be going for my birthday. So that's
nice.
Two firsts for me. And the first time I'm going as an adult. So I'm actually going to be, you know, like, traveling and seeing things that I was never able to see. Because where we're from is, like, 6 hours to the closest beach. So, it's, like, the middle of nowhere. There's really nothing to do where we're from besides, you know, just see family.
Yeah.
So, I'm really excited to go back.
Ooh, that's exciting. Yeah, that is very fun. Oh, my gosh. Okay, it's going to be, like, an entirely new experience.
Yeah,
it's not,
for sure.
Obviously, that many years later.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like,
wow.
I'm also one of the only, I'm one of, like, 92 cousins. We have a map, and that's just on my mom's side. Like,
if your family just backs you up and is the only customers for your business,
I'd be set for life. That's
it. You just need your family to buy your products.
Yeah.
That's it. It's, so, and I'm, like, one of the only ones that, like, doesn't have kids.
Mm.
So.
Nice.
I'm pretty excited to go back and actually be able to be like, all right, peace out, guys. I'm gonna go live my life. I'm really excited.
Yeah. What are the things about Brazil that you look forward to doing or like exploring, being around?
Honestly, I don't even know. Like, I'm gonna be going as a tourist because, like, what I remember of Brazil is, you know, where I'm from, and that's it. Like I said, there's really there's not that much to do over there. So I want to go, you know, to all the different places, experience the different foods from all around. I want to go to a beach. So I definitely want to go do a whole bunch of stuff. So yeah, I'm going as a complete tourist right now.
Yeah. It is interesting, like, to go to a country that's, like, your, like, family heritage. And it's, like, it is a part of you in a way because, like, even if you have never, like, been there, you haven't been there that much, like, your family has definitely been in this country. It's, like, you're kind of getting to, like I think you get to see your family in a different way, too, because now you're seeing, like, the experiences that they had almost, you know? So
I think it's the part that's crazy to me, too, is that I am most of, like, my aunts and uncles' age the last time I saw them. And it's, like, it's crazy because now I'm in their place. And, like, my nieces and nephews see me the same way I used to see them. And, like, it blows my mind to, like, put myself in that place now. And it's, like, shit, I'm an adult now. I am not going to sit at the kids' table anymore. I'm going to go there for fun. But
That's right. The kids' table is generally, like, a more fun atmosphere a lot of times, you know? It's because, like, you do spend a lot of time, like, wanting to get out of the kids' table and, like, wanting to be at the adult table because you're like, oh, like, what are they talking about over there? And then you get over there and it's, like, politics or, like, or like other, like, adult things, you know?
I always saw it in movies or TV shows where it's just, like, that, you know, the aunt who, like, drinks a bit too much and she's, like, just sitting there at the kids' table and she's like, hey, what's going on? Like, at whatever family events because, like, she is a little immature and doesn't go with the adults. Like, I always thought that girl was cool.
Yeah.
See, I'm going to be that, I'm going to be that aunt, except instead of being drunk, I'm going to be so high.
No, same. Nice. I'm also, I would be the high version.
I will be
version.
Like, you're 18, you want to take a little risk? Come on.
that actually is, like, a new part of, like, family parties that has, like, started to emerge. Like, as we kind of becomes, like, more generally accepted or people just, like, kind of clue into, like, the, like, harmlessness of it and, like, the, like, universal joy that kind of does bring a lot of people, you know? It's, like, fun to be, like, at family parties and it's like, all right, like, where are the weed smokers at? Like, you're trying to figure out who they are.
It's funny because, like, the family that I do have here in the United States, like, most of my cousins that are, like, around my age, we all smoke. And we all know we all smoke. And, like, during family parties, we'll all just be like, well, let's take a quick drive. Let's just head out. And it's like we all, like, pack into one car and then go on a little outride.
it's also, like, a community bonding, social bonding experience. It's different than drinking culture, for sure, that when you also have to, like, pass a joint or, like, if you're doing, like, there's something we weed out those certain people in parties or in families that are just like, like that type of person. And you're just like, oh, cool. You can chill with the person by not really saying much, but then the conversation just goes places because also when you're both high, it's just a very different experience than when you're under the influence with alcohol or anything.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. It was also pretty cool because once, like, I started doing everything and cooking and doing all this food, I actually threw a dinner for my cousins and I made, like, a traditional Brazilian meal and I infused all of it.
Oh my God.
And it was awesome because I didn't tell my parents we were doing this. So I made them, like, the same thing that we were eating, just non-infused. And I took it to, like, my mom's house and, like, my parents and my aunt ate. And then, like, all my cousins came over and we just hung out. We ate, we smoked, and it was a great time. And it was one of the first, like, big meals that I made infused. And it was, like, they were, like, my test subjects. Like, let's see how this goes. And it was a success. It was great. It was funny because I planned on taking so many pictures and creating content and doing all that stuff that night, and we got so high that I didn't take a single picture. I didn't do anything. Like, there was not a single way to prove that night existed.
To capture that moment just in your brain.
But it was a great night, and it was pretty
awesome.
Is that
where the idea of the business was cultivated?
No, I had actually already started the business. I started making edibles in 2018, but April 2020, my dog got really sick. We were already in lockdown, and long story short, and $8,000 later in vet bills, I pretty much had to figure out what to do, because in the same week that he got sick and all that happened, oh, I got laid off of work.
Oh, man.
No, it's, don't feel bad. I was trying to get fired so bad beforehand, so.
Yeah, losing a bad job is a good
thing. It was so funny, because when they called to, like, say, like, oh, you know, we have to lay you off and everything else, like, before they even said it, I'm like, listen, I understand it's hard times. You don't gotta say it. I'm here if you need me. But I was trying to get fired so bad. So not only did I get laid off and, like, I was able to claim unemployment and do all
blessing
that stuff.
Blessing in disguise.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But, you know, it was kind of like the motivation I needed to start all of this. Mm. So I started just making some stuff and giving it out to my friends. And, like, this is what I was telling you before. What I started with was something called brigadeiro. So brigadeiro is a traditional Brazilian treat. It's a kind of like a chocolate fudge. It's normally rolled into like little balls with sprinkles on it, but I usually make mine and put it into little cups. It just travels better, it's easier.
Mm-hmm.
But that's how I started off. I started making the brigadeiro and just giving it out to a bunch of people and being like, here, try this. And then I started selling them, and then my best friend kept pushing me. She's like, you need to make an Instagram page. You need to make a page. And I'm like, yeah, I'll do it. And then in August, I finally made an Instagram page.
Oh my God.
After a few months of her bothering me about it. And then, and then from there, it just, you know, it was kind of like word of mouth. And then I got like my first 100 followers. And I have a childhood friend who, she was my best, one of my best friends growing up. And I love her with all of my heart. She's a social media influencer. She was on like Drake's music video and everything.
Oh.
And I sent her some of my treats, and I was not expecting her to post anything about it. I was just sending it to her just to send it.
Right.
And she posted about it, and like the same day that I posted, like, oh, thanks for my first 100 followers, I hit my first 1,000 followers.
Wow.
And it was like,
that's
oh.
Nice.
And then it just pretty much blew up from there. And I started just getting more and more clients. I started getting messages from people literally from all around the world, like from Australia, like, I'm going to go there someday to go buy your food. And I'm like, it blows my mind to to think that, like, you know, all these people from around the world have seen what I do and like are interested in coming here. Like, I feel like some shit you see on like the Food Channel, on like Anthony Bourdain kind of thing. Like,
It's a thing though. It is like that business where they have shows on Apple, or I mean, there's another streaming service I can't think of, but on different networks where it's, you know, infused cooking.
Yeah. Mm. I know. I think, what's the one that I think 2 Chainz is on? Like, most expensive?
Hmm.
That one. I gotta look up and double check, yeah.
I definitely...
I'm pretty sure.
I was actually just talking to my boyfriend about it. I want to make the most expensive cheesesteak.
Hmm.
And it will be infused, and it'll have pretty gold leaf on it and everything.
Most
and
expensivest.
Most expensivest, yes.
That's amazing.
So I want to make the most expensivest cheesesteak and have 2 Chainz come try it.
Ooh, yes. Yeah. And we're talking about before the podcast about like how like you kind of have to like keep things fresh, and especially like in any kind of business you need to have freshness.
Yeah.
And like this is like a very exciting thing. I think people like are finding out more and more about like just like the whole culture of like edible and the things you could do with it. Because for a while it was like chocolate and like maybe gummies, maybe a
brownies,
drink. Yeah, right. Brownies was the OG.
Yeah.
Now it's like, but they're having chefs like
full-blown
like,
chefs,
like prepare stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I was just saying the other one I was thinking of was Bong Appetit.
Oh, yes.
Oh, there's
cooked with cannabis and then chopped 420.
There's actually one of the chefs that was, is it on Bong Appetit? One of those shows. She follows me on Instagram, and she's always like commenting on my posts and sending me things, and she's awesome. And it's funny because watching her on TV, like, she's crazy. She's wild. Like, it's, she, at least one of the things, one of the competitions that I saw, like, she wasn't like properly dosing her food, and they'd be like, oh yeah, how many milligrams? She's like, I don't know, high. I'm like, I like that.
Yeah. Well, so that, but that, like, that is another element though to cooking.
Is that Dora Lavorado you're referring
too? No.
She's on Bon Appetit. Just because if people are listening to this and they want to know specifically,
let me go on Instagram right now and I'll find her.
I think that's amazing that you've gotten this support from everybody, that which doesn't surprise me because this is such a great service.
Yeah.
Her name's Cynthia Cecido. She was on Top Chef and Cooked with Cannabis.
Got you. Shout out to Cynthia. Nice.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's pretty cool. And it's just, there's a lot to it. There's, you can literally make anything. You can infuse anything.
Mm-hmm.
So you could infuse drinks. You could infuse empanadas like I brought for you guys.
Yeah, yo, guys, Gabby gave us a treasure trove of great things. We got empanadas. What kind of juice did you say this was?
It's called Cash Passion. It is a cashew juice mixed with passion fruit juice. And it's just delicious.
And what kind of empanadas are they?
Vegan beef empanadas.
Oh, beef.
Yeah.
Vegan beef. I was curious what was in it.
Yeah, we got some coffee. Like, we got sauce. We got some
there's coffee. I don't think I've ever tried infused coffee.
Yeah.
It's going to be amazing.
Like, how has, like, the culture changed in the time that you've been making edibles in terms of, like legality stuff, but also just in the terms of, like, the acceptance of it as, like, a regular
When I started everything, it was still only medically legal in the state. It still wasn't recreational or anything. But after it being recreationally legalized, I have gotten a lot more parents as customers, which is really funny because my best friend's mom is now like in one of my top customers. And it's funny because before that, she was so against it. And she hated every time that I would go over because she knew I was only there for us to smoke.
Yeah.
So, like, it's funny because now every time she sees me, she's like, oh, do you have some juice? do you got some sauce? Like, and she loves all of it. So, since you know, legalization in this pretty much year and a half that I've been doing everything, there's been like a lot of change. The one thing I still would love to see is, you know, more laws made specifically for edibles, because it was pretty much left out of this most recent bill and everything. So technically, this is still kind of illegal.
Yeah.
And what they are legalizing as far as edibles is kind of bullshit.
Mm.
So hopefully they change that and, you know, we are able to come out of the grinder. You know, I hope that in this next year and a half, we are able to come out and be more out with it, but there's still a lot to go. But we've come a long way. We've come a very long way. And, you know, it's definitely more accepted now. It's definitely a little less taboo than it normally or was before.
Yeah.
But there is still a huge, like, negative black cloud around it because of, you know, the stigma that there was around it, the badness that there is associated with weed.
Yeah.
So until, like, people, you know, really give it a chance and educate themselves and see what it is that, you know, this can actually do for you, there's still going to be, like, all that negativity around it.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's endless possibilities, and I've seen people who were so against it become so for it, so I am very hopeful.
Yeah. Well, I think it's one of the positive things about, like, consuming weed in edible form is that, like, it kind of, because, like, I understand, like, the idea of smoking is not for everyone, just, like, in general, so it doesn't matter what it is, like, they're going to be, like, a little turned off to it, but it's nice someone could be, like, well, I do like juice, I do like coffee, I do like empanadas, I do like all these things.
Exactly.
And it's almost like, it kind of like breaks down like a little bit of that barrier in order to like let you get in, because it's a little more familiar to you if you're eating it or drinking it.
Exactly. The one thing that like I love too is that, you know, not only is this fun for people to do, but I've been able to help so many people, like from cancer patients to people suffering from anxiety to insomnia, like everything you can think of. I've had so many people like, oh, you have no idea, you've saved me. Like, I haven't been able to sleep in weeks, and I finally was able to sleep a night. I've had cancer patients literally tell me that they hated their pain medication, and they completely changed from pain medication to edibles.
Mm.
And they've been able to function and be pain-free And it's funny because I even gave my neighbor some edibles because a few months back she fell down her stairs and broke some ribs. And she told me she's been having pain and she hasn't been able to sleep. And I was like, oh, do you want to try some stuff? And she's like, my niece gave me some things and it wasn't that good and I didn't really like it. And I'm like, here, try this. Take about a third of it, 30 minutes before bed, and you'll be great. The next morning, she came, like, almost crying. She's like, I haven't been able to sleep a whole night in 30 years.
Wow.
And she was, like, I literally ran inside, and I got, like, a bunch more, and I'm like, here, take it.
Oh, my god.
So, like, it's, you know.
Yeah, you're really helping people.
It's awesome.
It makes a difference.
Oh, it really does, and it makes me feel so good and it pushes me to want to do more.
Sure.
And like, because you know, you never know who you could be helping. You never know like just what people are going through. And like, to us, it's just edibles, but to some people that's literally a lifesaver.
Mm.
Yeah. I mean, pain relief, you're providing people's relief from having some, like sometimes
chronic pain.
Like stuff that they have probably, like that woman said, 30 years, like stuff that people have lived with for a very, very long time. And you're just able to alleviate that and you're able to do good with the business.
Yeah.
It's not even just like, oh, making a product and like selling it and being, you know, I don't know. It's not even like competing with people, because in any industry, there's a little competition. Well, there's a bunch of people trying to do the same thing you are.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, for you to be around here in this area makes a huge difference. Like, you know what I'm saying? We're not in the West Coast. Like, a huge thing is when we have people in this podcast who are local or people who are doing things for their community and even bigger. Like, you're reaching more, which is wonderful. But, like, also, when you said North Arlington, I was just like, what? I was like, you're that close? I didn't, what? Before I forget, a question I wanted to ask you is, what is the difference or, like, level of difficulty for making, like, infusing juices versus coffee versus sauce versus when you're making with empanadas? Because, obviously, you can't just, like, you know, blend as much as you want. Or with making the oils, like... Because we have a product, Levo, or there's something that we make.
I'm not a fan of the Levo. Use the butter.
Mm.
So the Levo, you can only, it says that you're supposed to be able to get more out of less flour.
Mm-hmm.
But I really don't think so. You're only able to do, I think it's 8 grams at a time?
I think
if you like take out the little chamber and like put a screen on the inside, you're able to do, I think, at most 14 grams or something like
that. How much you were able to do with the other one?
I can do 3 ounces at a time.
Wow.
Damn.
That's a difference.
So So I'm able to do a lot more at a time.
Well, you're gonna make more, yeah.
Yeah, and the thing that, like, the Levo is convenient because, you know, it decarbs and everything all in one machine. It's nicer and it, like, strains everything for you. But, you know, for putting in a little extra work, you get way more product. I feel like the Levo is good for personal use if you're just making it for yourself.
Yes, gotcha.
But for... mass production.
Yes.
Magical butter is definitely the way to go. I actually have two of them because I have to keep always just making stuff.
Yeah.
So
what is like one of your favorite things to make?
I don't know.
Or what are you putting also on like your list of
classics? I can tell you what my least favorite thing
to
make.
What's that? And do people order it often?
Yes. The brigadeiro, the OG, the thing that I started with. And the only reason I hate making it is because I use condensed milk. And I always cut myself on the stupid can. I always have a problem where when I'm scraping out the can, I will always just slice a piece of my finger or something. And I'm like, oh. And sometimes
it's for the people.
The people need me.
Yeah. So it's sometimes I'm whenever I'm gonna do it, I'm like, oh my god, and I'll wear gloves and everything, but it slices.
Wow,
and
I did not think that was gonna be the reason. That condensed milk can.
If
only you could get it out of different plastic containers.
If I could get a plastic container with a bottle, it would be the easiest thing to make. make, but it's just the stupid cans.
Yeah, cans are a little dangerous.
They
you know?
Are very dangerous.
Have you ever used an electric can opener before?
My mom had one.
Yes,
yeah.
my parents have one of those, and I kind of want to get one.
Yo, they're cool, but definitely sometimes when I've used it, it just keeps rotating. and you're like, stopped hitting the button, you're unclicked it, because you're just supposed to click, or this
click
machine,
one.
You click it once,
yeah.
And then it just does it for you, and then, but then you're just, like, fighting with it, and just trying to take the can back, and it's been a frightening experience.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're great, I'm saying, I just do enjoy the old fashioned way, but then I also feel old, because I'm like, my hands are crafty.
But you know what? You know what I've learned?
More weed in my
mouth. It really depends on your can opener, because I have one that's like, you have to crank it, and like, yo, my arm gets a little tired after opening a bunch of cans.
Yeah.
But like, I have one that is smooth as butter. And like, literally with like a few fingers, barely putting pressure, it just glides over the can. It's amazing. So it really just depends on what you have.
Cheap one. Yeah. But I feel like the more I crank it, my right arm is gonna be way buffer than my left.
Like, did you go to the gym? No, I just opened a can.
I opened several condensed milk with my friend because he was being attacked.
Yeah. So what's like the daily process for you? Like with like how much food do you make on like a daily or weekly basis?
It really depends. The good thing about like, you know, working for myself is that if one day I want to just not do anything, I can just not do anything. Like, I'm gonna be backed up the next few days, but I have that liberty to do it. So I mean, it really depends. It depends on how much like I'm posting on Instagram, because posting means messages, means orders. So you know, it really just depends.
What was your hesitation for not having Instagram for the longest time?
I don't know. I'm scared. It is a risk. It's
scared of what?
The legality, getting caught, putting myself out there. Because at that point...
Because I feel like people are just quite public about it now. So
well, I am. Since making the page, I've become a lot more public with my use, with everything.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. But like back then, it was like only on my close friends list. Did
people know that I
smoke?
I see what you're saying. Yes. No.
So now both of my pages are linked. Everybody knows what I do. Like,
well, yeah, was that it wasn't a shock to your family, you said, right? Or you was, right? Did they know? But I'm saying like all your cousins, and then you like,
yeah,
they
cousins,
know that you're like cook and familiar.
Yeah, my cousins, I mean, they knew I smoked, but nobody really knew like what. When I started making edibles 3 years ago, all of my cousins got really shitty cookies for Christmas. First experience with my edibles.
Gotcha.
And then they didn't have it again until the dinner, so they were kind of skeptical too, because they were like, we've had your stuff.
Yeah.
And like back then I had no idea what I was doing. It was like my first batch of cookies, and I was like, fuck it, this is what everybody's getting for Christmas.
Yeah.
So
what's one of the differences between baking and cooking?
I suck at baking and I'm great at cooking.
Alright, that is just I just thought there was maybe there's something different with like, you know, infusing each, but it's basically
yes and no.
Bare bones
so
the same.
They're you know, cooking with weed isn't just cooking with weed.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of science that
sure,
goes behind
yep.
it, because you know, the process of it isn't you don't just throw bud in. Obviously, you know,
yes.
you gotta decarb,
yes.
you have to, it has to be at a specific temperature. And one thing I've started reading a lot more into is how to express the different cannabinoids depending on what temperature you decarb.
Mm-hmm.
So you can get more CBD, you can get more THC,
mm-hmm.
depending on how long, how hot,
right,
you know.
Right.
So there's a lot of like science that goes behind it. And then that also transfers into like once the product is ready, you can't heat up THC too much, because then you burn it away.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to do research into what it is that you're going to be making, and you have to decide at what point you're going to be adding in the oil, the honey, the
yeah.
butter, whatever it is,
mm-hmm.
because you have to keep it in for an amount of time for everything to emulsify and mix in, but not too much time that it's going to burn away.
Mm-hmm.
So it is a little bit of a,
sure. yeah.
of a process.
Yeah.
But
But look at your growth.
Yeah. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Were you interested in science? Because it sounds like you like that's a part of like the like this whole like process of like becoming accustomed to science.
Okay. Kind of. Yeah. But if you ask me, like in school, was I good at science? Not really.
Yeah.
But like, I was very interested in it, but I just sucked at it.
Yeah.
But I've always been really, really interested in like edibles and just weed and like, I remember years ago watching, it was on 420. They always have like documentaries on like Vice and things like
yeah.
that. I remember watching a documentary about how, they were using cannabis to help treat like seizures and just all these crazy different, like sicknesses and
mm-hmm.
diseases and just all of it. And that got me interested because my dog, the same one that got sick this year,
yeah.
which was the motivation for everything, he has been epileptic and he's had seizures since he was 2. He's now 11.
Mm.
So that got me thinking, like, is that something that can help my dog?
Mm.
Like, so I started doing more research into it and started looking more into CBD and things like that. And I've always been interested in like that medical aspect of it.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I started doing everything with making the edibles, that was kind of like the direction that I always wanted to go in, was to be able to, you know, make this bottle of sauce right here. And this is going to be exactly this much CBD. And this is great for anxiety. Like, it's specifically for this one thing. So
mm-hmm.
Like, that's my goal with everything, and that's where
yeah.
I want to go in, like, the direction that I want to go in.
That's great.
And I just think that's, it's amazing that you can do that with this, like.
For sure. That's where I think a lot of medicine and science is going in the direction of, something
yeah.
where you can target a specific area, where
yeah.
you can
mm-hmm.
get to. I was, telling this to Brendan the other day, because I love getting up at Sunday morning, you know, 9 a.m. watching CBS Sunday morning. Because I like the little news. I don't know if you've ever seen it. I like the program, and I like the, you know, the news interviews, whatever they capture. And there was one where they're talking about, which I guess in a way it's shell shock therapy, but very like advanced technology. Well, they put this, you know, little device on someone's forehead, and they're going like sending magnetic pulses to a specific area of your cerebral that's helping people with depression.
Oh, wow.
So like, how wicked would it be if you could also do that with marijuana, a specific strain, something you're targeting specifically? Oh, it's going to go towards this part of your brain.
Yeah.
Or like, yeah, this is going to be specifically for anxiety. This specifically will help you, your muscles, or help you, your joint pain, help you sleep and do this and whatever, whatever. And like, it's in, you know, other states. I feel
yeah.
like it's definitely, you know, the wave will come this way over time. Hopefully we have.
The thing with that is, even what they do have right now, like for therapeutic purposes, like RSO, it's super high dose and it's disgusting. It normally comes in like a syringe and it's gross.
Oh.
But imagine being able to take the RSO and a sauce, like,
yes,
you're just
right.
eating some nuggets, dipping it in, and you're
right.
getting your medication.
Yeah,
and it's specifically for what, you know, is going on. It's
yes.
it's catered to you, to what's going on. And like, I want to be able to do that. I want to be able to have something that people are going to enjoy while getting their actual medication.
Sure. Also, because like, a concern a lot of people have with edibles is sometimes people don't have the greatest edible stories.
Oh,
like, they
yes.
have experiences, you know
yeah.
what I'm saying? Like, anytime someone's eating an edible, and like, all of our bodies react differently
yeah.
for sure. Which, you know, finding out medication that's like, you were saying, specific to each individual, where it's like your gene makeup, I don't know,
mm-hmm.
like your DNA, like something that's actually, this is your composition, different than, you know, Rena's is different than Brendan's, is different than, yeah.
So there's a name for that. It's actually called your endocannabinoid system.
Ooh,
yeah.
Say
tell
us
again.
More.
Yeah, yeah.
You said the
do
secret
want,
word.
Do you want me to say it slowly?
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah.
Close to the mic.
Endocannabinoid system. So pretty much what that is just like every system you have in your body, it's receptors that is going to receive the THC and is going to determine your high. So, like you said, there are people who've had terrible edible stories, but then have you ever seen the people that it's like, I ate so many edibles and I didn't feel shit?
There are people who don't have a reaction.
It's
because they don't have that many endocannabinoids in their digestive tract. So, yeah, so a lot of people, a lot more people have it like in their lungs and everything, and that's where like when you smoke, you're gonna feel it more, but a lot of people don't have it in their and their digestive tract, so that's where they don't feel the
Is that like a genetic thing mostly, or are there things you can eat to make to like kind of change that for yourself?
I have no idea. I really don't know if it's a genetic thing. I don't think so, because I've gotten like siblings who one has like a half of something and is dying, the other one can eat like can drink like six bottles of juice and not feel a single thing. So
yeah,
like
it's not passed down.
Yeah,
it's probably not hereditary.
So I really don't know.
Maybe it's just your enzymes. It's the type of enzymes.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I have no idea.
But you know, there's a lot more research. There's a lot more research to be done on that.
For sure, absolutely. Yeah. Which is wonderful, because I feel like when they require even more data, it's just like it's just gonna help us.
Oh.
We just need to know more information
more
about
time,
it
for
yeah.
sure.
What if you'd be so kind as to share your first experience with weed, the first time you got high? Also, if that is, you know, your first edible experience, or if that is a bad edible experience, whatever you want to share.
So the first time I got high was with my cousin in her basement, and we smoked out of an apple, and it was really funny because it was a mission for us to get there, because we were supposed to first, we were supposed to meet up and hang out with, like, her friends, and then we were all supposed to smoke together. So when we got to the friend's house, they had already smoked without us, but we still had, like, our little baggie of weed ready to go. And I think we were, I must have been, I think, like, 15 or 16 at the time or something. And we're like, oh, did you guys get wrapped for us? And they're like, no, we smoked it already. And we're like, so how are we gonna smoke? And they're like, I don't know. So then we're like, oh, we don't even want to hang out with you guys, we're gonna go.
Yeah.
So we decide to walk back to her house. Now apparently I didn't know that we were gonna be walking like 3 miles back to her house, and it was freezing, and it was already like 10 o'clock at night. So number one, no place is open. And then number two, we're like 16. Nobody's gonna sell you a freaking tobacco wrap.
Yeah.
And so we're like, oh my God, what are we gonna do? We asked so many people to buy it for us. Nobody wanted to help us. And then we eventually got to her place, and we're like, all right, what are we gonna do? So we waited for everybody to go to sleep, and she went into the kitchen and she got an apple and she made it into a little makeshift bong thing, and it was the best high of my life, and I couldn't stop laughing. It was great, and I loved it. And yeah, it was awesome. And
that is so great.
It was a great time.
Yeah.
Out of an apple.
Apple gets the job done.
Apple
yeah.
a day.
It definitely
keeps the doctor away.
If you throw it hard enough.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, what was your first edible experience?
I don't remember.
It was that bad, huh?
Honestly, well, actually, no, I'm lying. I do remember, because my dog almost died that day.
Oh,
so I had a friend who made a bunch of cookies, and he gave me one, and he's like, only eat half.
Okay.
So I ate half, and I put the other half in a little Ziploc bag. And
oh, you actually listened?
I did.
Wow, good.
So
yeah.
I was good. I felt great. Like,
yeah.
It was all right. And then I got home, and I, like, threw the baggie on top of my bed, and whatever, went to sleep. And at that time, I only had two dogs. So I had my little Chihuahua, and I have a little Yorkie. And I wake up in the middle of the night with the Yorkie puking her brains out. And I'm like, what the hell's going on? So I'm cleaning up her throw up, and I'm like, that smells familiar.
Yeah.
I'm like, what is that smell? I'm like, oh my God. So I'm just cleaning it, and then I'm like, the cookie! And I go crazy, like, flipping my sheets and everything, trying to find it. And then I find the bag, and like the half of the cookie is half eaten. And she's a 4-pound Yorkie. I felt so bad. I took her outside, and I'm like, oh my God, she's gonna fucking die. I'm like, eat grass, come on, eat grass. You'll be okay. And I really thought she was just gonna die.
She was all right.
She was fine.
Okay.
She was totally fine. They've eaten a lot of edibles since then. Which, you know, is not the greatest, but that Chihuahua that has all the health issues, it slows his heart down, which is great because he has an enlarged heart that beats way too fast. So it actually really helps him out.
It's like regulating.
It totally regulates him. And it helps with his seizures. But I don't like to give it to him because, you know, sometimes he gets too high and he can't even walk.
Yeah. Well, it's all about dosage, right?
Yeah.
I mean, they'd have businesses where it's marijuana for dogs.
Yeah. Oh, no, for sure.
Well, I guess a lot. Actually, I don't know. I don't know what the balance is between what they're giving the dogs, if it's mostly CBD. It's probably,
from what I've been giving my dog, it's mostly CBD.
Right, yeah.
The THC that he's consumed has been completely accidental. Like, all of
it.
It's been a few times, but it's been completely accidental every time.
That would just be too much for, we gotta just check back in with the challenge.
Yes.
The challenge was
to name U.S. Capital cities, so capitals in the U.S.,
Don't worry. I mean, we definitely steered you away from that.
Right.
Just because we wanted to know immediately about you.
I literally don't know any capital cities.
That's fine.
No way.
Because I will tell you that the low bar is zero, so you would not be zero in the podcast.
Is it like Trenton?
Trenton.
All right, I got one.
There we go.
Albany.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Those are the two most important ones.
You know, I was in third grade, and you had to memorize all the state capitals.
Yeah, we did too.
Quiz on it.
Everybody,
I smoked
a lot
of
weed since
then. Oh, yeah, exactly. No, you know what? When I was a teenager, I thought I would remember everything I ever learned. And it's between getting older.
You thought that?
Oh, you know,
as a teenager, you thought you were going to remember
because
everything.
I was like, I remember everything else that's happened in my life basically up until this point now. Why wouldn't I remember more? And then I found out, not probably like 5 or 6 years later, that was not the case.
But
yeah.
See, at least you realize that, because even though I know that, I still always tell myself, yeah, I'll remember this. And then I completely forget everything.
Yeah.
Oh, I never trust my memory.
I'm
yeah.
terrible, and I haven't learned yet.
Do you always have to like write things down on your phone or make sticky notes or something? Like,
yes. And most of the time I know I should write them down, and I'm like, no, I'll remember it. It's important, I'll remember it. I don't.
Do you get, for inspiration for, like, things that you want to make, because we were also talking about this before, too, about how you do kind of want to, like, always be cycling, like, new ideas and new items and new food, because people want to see new stuff, you know, people do love the new. And so do you, like, just get, like, inspiration for things out of the blue, or how does it come to you, usually?
I like to stick to things that I eat. So if I really like something, I'm going to try to infuse it. I also love watching food on TV and everything. My boyfriend is a huge foodie, so we always just go out different places. And everywhere we go, like, I'll look at the menu and I'll see, like, what it is. I'm like, I can totally infuse this. Like, I can totally make this. Mm. So it's, you know, definitely get inspiration from everywhere. But mostly, I like to, like I said, stick to things that I know how to make, things that, you know, comfort foods.
Yeah.
It does go well with the whole, like, the aesthetic of, like, being high, too, because it's, like, that's, like, one of, like, the positive things is sometimes, like, when weed hits you the right way, it does kind of make you feel comfortable, especially if you have, like, a nice indica and, like, you're, like, settling in for the night and you're, like, I am going to become a part of this couch right now. And that is exactly the mood I'm in right now.
Yeah.
And it's even better when you take an edible, because, like, when you're smoking, it's kind of, like, instant, but when you're taking an edible, like, you'll take it and you'll just be watching TV, and then, like, out of nowhere, you feel like you're part of the couch.
Yeah.
And you're like, this is great.
And you just ride it. Yeah.
And, like,
just like,
and
no,
like, in your head, you know how to move, but, like, your body doesn't.
Yeah.
Like, you're just like, yeah, I want to get up right now. And it's like, but how?
Yeah. Your body's like, I don't see a reason for you to move, so why would we move?
There
then
is no dire emergency right
now.
You don't need to get up.
Sometimes I, like, count down in my head where I'm just like, all right, Rena, get up in one. And then there's like 2 minutes and like nothing happens, you're just sitting there. I'm like, oh,
so I'll give myself 10 seconds.
And then
10 seconds go by.
You gotta keep resetting the clock until you forget that you're resetting a clock, and while you're sitting there you got distracted with something else, and then you just, you know, then there you go.
But and then sometimes I have really productive edible moments too. Like where sometimes, like, it really just lights a fire and I am doing everything.
Yeah.
And it gets me, like, so focused. Like, it's
I wish I was that when I'm high or when I have edibles.
See, I don't know when I'm going to be like that, though. So sometimes so I'll take an edible with the intention of being that productive and doing all of that. And the complete opposite happens where I just won't move and I won't get up. And then that's when I do like the countdown in my head about 40 times.
Yeah.
And I still don't get up.
Yeah.
Have you guys ever like either from smoking or eating like gotten so high that you feel like it's like you don't feel like you don't have like super strength, but you feel like a superhero almost. Like it gives you like a super energy in you. It's kind of like what you're saying too, where it's like it makes you feel like you want to like go run around and do things, or what is your normal high experience when you get high?
I think at this point now, I just, you know, I'm pretty chill. I am still very functional. I can do a lot. I know my limit.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm just like, once I know I'm good, I'm okay. I don't gotta do anything else.
Yes.
But that
know your
superhuman feeling I did get from shrooms.
We can go down that rabbit hole if you want.
I also
agree with you, Brendan. Yes. Sometimes I do feel, superhuman when you're like high, you just feel unstoppable.
Yeah,
or you can even like, when you're running while high, it's definitely, I feel like you have longer stamina.
So I used to be like super into the gym, and every time before going into the gym, I would sit in the parking lot and like hotbox my car, and I would have the best workout of my life.
You
really do endure a lot more.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. What are we lighting up?
This is Great Diamonds.
Ooh, everybody get another hit if you're, you know, smoking or edibling along with us. Make sure you drink your water or your tea or your soda or anything else that'll keep you hydrated. Also, quick plug-in, Late Night Hump. This Friday, November 12th, 9:30 p.m., Players Theater in New York City. We're back with the Interdimensional Improv Show. Come watch it. It's going to be super fun. Use code HUMP. That's all you got to use. You got to use that code. You get 50% off.
Yeah, guys, we've literally never had anyone come to the show who didn't enjoy it. And and we'll take you to some crazy places. Also, just keep listening to Sessions of Mary Jane so you get more episodes like this. We have usually about like two every week that come out. And then also just listen to The Morning Shower. It's our daily news podcast. So be sure to keep checking that out. We got a lot of good things coming for you. Thank you, Gabby, again for smoking us up with this wonderful circle of little pre-rolls. It's amazing.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
I'm just going to check in with those capitals again.
Oh.
Just in case you want to add anything to the list.
I was
just
thinking and...
Yeah. Well, so where have you traveled? Like where are your favorite places?
Oh, wait, also shrooms.
Oh, okay.
Yes. that was the most Sessions of Mary Jane moment of all time. Like, three conversations at once. We gotta get them all. All right, go.
Yeah, well, the audience are probably used to that by now.
Okay.
I want to know your shrooms experience.
Yes, yes.
So my all-time favorite shrooms experience was the first time I was doing shrooms by myself, which I highly recommend everybody do it by themselves at least once. It is so like spiritual and self-discovering. It's awesome. I loved it. But the first time I was doing shrooms alone, I don't even remember how I ate it. I think I put it like with some Oreos and just chopped it down. It was disgusting.
It's just terrible.
Wait, so Oreo was the chaser to the shrooms?
It was like at the same time.
Ah, okay.
Because I'm super grossed out by shrooms, and if I chew on them, I immediately start gagging. So I have
chocolate cup.
Yeah, I need like another texture or something while I'm eating.
Got you.
Too.
Yeah.
So I took them, and then like immediately after taking them, I'm like, oh my God, I still have to be responsible. Let me go like walk my dogs and do everything before I start tripping.
Mm-hmm.
So I take my dogs out for a walk, and I guess like it had already started like hitting. And when I was out there, I felt like, I felt like everybody was outside that day. And then my dogs are not that nice. They bark at everybody. Like they're not nice. And I felt like everybody that one day wanted to come play with my dogs. And it was just bad. So I was like, all right, let me get back inside. So I'm like, okay, let's see what I can do. Let me turn on the TV. So I put on Alice in Wonderland. It was not a good idea either. Mm. And then I changed it to something.
That's your first thought. Got you.
That goes it's an instinct though, because it does feel like the kind of movie you should put on when you are on your trip.
It does. Yeah, no, don't do it. It's terrible.
Was it like creepy? Creeping you out, you mean? Like
yeah.
The visuals?
It wasn't like, I wasn't like fully tripping yet, but like the pre-trip anxiety was hitting me.
Got you.
And I was just like, I can't watch that.
Mm-hmm.
So I just turned it off, and then I just turned on my music. And I started listening to music, and I have like the Hughes Phillips light bulbs that like change colors.
Mm.
And then I also have an app that like syncs my music to
Ooh.
My life.
Yes, I have that.
Oh,
I have that same thing.
Amazing.
Yes.
Amazing. So I just laid in bed. I laid in my bed and I just looked at the lights and it was amazing.
And that's it. That's all you need.
It was funny because I would like close my eyes, and then if I close my eyes just like softly, I would see like one thing, and I remember like if I put pressure on like my eyeballs, it was really weird because then I started seeing what looked like eyeballs, and then it looked like fingers coming out of the eyeballs and pushing them open, but and then the fingers would get really long and it would turn into spider legs.
Ooh.
And I was just like, okay, I don't like that. So I like took that out, and then I would like open my eyes, and then I started smoking at the same time that I was tripping. And
Ooh,
every
way to escalate it.
And then every layer.
Wait, I'm sorry, you were looking in the mirror?
No. I was just laying in bed. I was just looking. I had my eyes closed when I was seeing all of
this. Oh,
so
oh, oh.
I had my
I
eyes closed and
seeing,
it was just in my head.
Got you, okay.
And then I opened my eyes and I started like smoking, and the colors were changing with the lights, but it was like it was smoke, but every layer, like every time it would change colors in my head, it was like this layer would stay blue, this layer was red. So it looked like a rainbow.
Mm.
And I was like, oh my God, this is so amazing. And then I decided I wanted to like open the window because it was like a summer. It was like in August. It was August of last year. And I opened the window, and this is the part where I don't know if this was in my head or if this was really going on. I heard music. I was hearing like traditional Indian music, and I was like, oh, somebody must have it on in like their house or something. It's like it was just coming in through the windows, and I kept hearing children like laughing and playing, which is, you know, in the summertime where I live, there's a lot of kids. It wasn't something that was totally outrageous to be hearing. But I don't know if I really heard it or not. But and then I just started hearing music. And I started hearing these kids playing, and I closed my eyes again, and I was like, what's that goddess that's like the lady with like the bunch of arms?
Shiva?
Yes. That's who I don't know, maybe that's who it is.
Let me double check.
Yeah.
Pretty sure.
But that's who I turned into. And then I kept hearing kids, so like in my head, there was like kids running all around me, and it just felt great. So then like that moment passed, and I'm like, I'm kind of hungry. I want to go eat. So I decide to, like, walk to my kitchen, and I had this tiny little, like, lantern. I wish I could show you guys a picture of it. Mm-hmm. But it's like, you know, like, when you're at, like, the checkout aisle, like, you see, like, little kids' toys? Mm-hmm. It was a tiny little lantern. It looks like the ones that, like, people take camping, but it's, like, this big.
Oh, yes.
It's, like, an inch. Mm-hmm. It's super tiny, but it actually works. And in my tripping, I turned on that little light, and I kept saying, like, if this little light goes out, I'm done. Like, I don't know what's gonna happen. And then at some point, because I had the light on for such a long time, it started flickering. I started freaking out.
Oh my God.
I'm like, oh my God, what's gonna happen? So, I had all the lights off in my apartment, and at this point, it's already, like, maybe, like, 8 o'clock in August. It's, like, just starting to, like, get dark and everything, so I didn't have any lights on, and I'm, like, walking through my apartment, and in my head, I was being really loud, and I had to be really quiet so none of my neighbors heard me. So I'm, like, tiptoeing through my apartment with this little light, just holding it, like, trying to get to the kitchen, and then I made some food or whatever, and then I decided to, like, open my door, and I used to have, like, a bunch of plants in front of my, my apartment, mm-hmm. and I opened the door, and the moment I opened the door, it was, like, a personal concert going on, and my plants were singing to me.
Oh.
And it was amazing! Oh, it was the craziest thing. There was, like, a nice, beautiful breeze, and, like, as they were, like, swaying in the wind, they were dancing and singing.
Oh, my gosh.
And it was funny, because, like, if anybody was outside looking in, they would have just seen me looking like a dumbass.
Yeah.
And, like, were just, like, staring at my plants. But it was amazing, and it was a personal concert. And then I ended up making some food, and then, like, I came down from the trip, but it was the most phenomenal trip of my life.
Wow.
And it was just so cool. And, like, there was, like, a lot more that went on, but those were the really cool parts.
Wow. Thank you for sharing.
Yeah, so
that's really neat.
Okay, what was the other question that we were trying to...
Do you travel a lot? Like, are there a lot of places in the country that you've traveled to?
I have been to every state on the East Coast.
Mm.
And that's about it. I haven't traveled anywhere besides the East Coast.
Yeah.
And Brazil.
Oh, yeah, and Brazil. Exactly.
Right.
And Puerto Rico.
Right.
I went to Puerto Rico for the first
cool.
time this year. It was awesome.
Oh,
cool.
Definitely want to go back.
Oh.
But yeah, I think that's pretty much it. I definitely want to go to a lot more states. I want to go, like, out west and everything. Definitely want to travel the world.
Yeah.
But one of my plans is, I wanted to do, what's that movie? I think it's called Chef. Have you seen it?
Yeah, where it's like the guy, the gourmet chef, gets the food truck.
That's,
that's
John Favreau.
Yeah,
that's
Favreau,
what I wanted. That's really what I wanted to do.
Sofia Vergara is in that movie?
Yes.
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 Yeah.
That's really what I wanted to do, and I wanted to, like, get a food truck and go to, like, all these different states. I wanted to do that this summer, and then just a lot just started happening and didn't work out, but still definitely something I want to do.
Yes.
Oh, you can still make that happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wanted to, like, go to every state, stay, like, a weekend, and just, like, I'm only there for these 2 days.
Mm.
Come through.
Would it be an edibles truck?
Yeah.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah.
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 What? And it's just that it would be the name of your business?
Yeah.
Or is, like, the van gonna get, like, a special, like, name? Food truck name or something, you know, where it's just,
it's
like...
It's Gabby's on the go.
Yeah.
Like,
it's always something with the go. That alliteration. Can't beat that.
Yeah. It's like, that's, like, one of the coolest things that, like, food trucks have become just, like, a legitimate place to get, like, really great food. Because,
yeah.
Probably for a while, food trucks were seen as, like, oh, like, what's this that you're buying? Oh, also, that is one of the coolest layers I've ever seen in my entire life. Like, we're all, like, laying up. We're just, like, using these, like, caveman
it's
layers.
A little torch. Here, I'll leave this one with you guys.
Wait, really?
Like,
oh,
caveman
my
lighters?
God.
What's wrong with their lighters?
No, they're regular old
isn't
lighters.
Isn't it weird? It all says Bic?
Yeah.
Like, Bic pen?
Yeah, it's the
same
company. Yeah.
I just realized that now. They make pens and lighters?
Yeah, it's weird. We're crossover. Like,
what else do they make?
A lot of stuff.
Yeah, they own Fox News.
They make razors. Like, that you
oh,
shave.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And a lot of times it is, like, the cheapest version of it. Like,
yes.
Right? It's like the cheapest pens are, like,
the blue ones.
I hate those.
Okay. The pens I don't have a problem with. Their razors, like, are the plastic, blue plastic.
Yeah.
Those ones are, total cheap.
Like, the single blade ones that you get at, like, the dollar store.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Like, we were talking about before about the whole thing with the can opener of, like, oh, like, you, like, want to get a good one, but sometimes you're just like, ah, this one's the cheapest one. I want to get this one. I've had that with razors, too, where I'm like, oh, I'm going to spend, like, a lot. Because, like, razors can be expensive, you know? Especially if you get, like, a really, like, a nice one. And I'm like, man, like, there's a part of me that can't rationalize, like, why would I spend, like, $20 on one item when I can get 20 for the same exact price? But then you use them and you're like, oh, I know why this is a dollar, because my face is, like, torn to shreds. So.
Speaking of razors, you know what's funny to me is when they have women, like, the women's razors commercials, and they came out with one with, like, Venus, where it's just like, now with this razor, you can, like, shave up and down. Like, you're not just going in one direction. And I'm just like, bitch, I've already been doing that with my razor, like a lawnmower across your leg. And they show it as if it's the first thing they fucking invented. And then also they're like, blades is strong as a like men's razor, and it's just like we've been buying men's razors because your blades are not strong enough.
We're ahead of you.
It's just like, yeah. Do you like ever go out and do like I don't know like Venus on the street and then just ask people like Billy on the street? Yeah. Asking actual customers like how they use your like then you would have gotten fucking honest answers. It's just anyway that just pops into my head. But yeah, it's why not? Like let's go. Let's like pivot the market. Let's change it up. Make women's material the same as men's. Yeah. You're not. Trust me, we can take more. Do you think men get as many waxes as women? I don't know. I can't say. Maybe men do actually.
You know, my mom is a professional waxer, and she gets a lot of men. She gets. I want to. She
okay. Laser hair removal. You don't get a lot of men with that, do you?
I don't think so.
Yeah. I guess, like, there's, like, probably still, like, a stigma attached to, like, I think in general, like, just, like, any kind of, like, hair or body care, like, there's, like, still this, like, weird thing with men where it's, like, still kind of, like, some people still see it as, like, a, like, feminine thing to, like, take care of your body
yeah.
and, like, have any kind of, like, sense
that's
of...
That's so stupid.
You know? I guess
some people
yeah.
are just uncomfortable with it.
Yeah.
Like, it's... Yeah.
Also supporting the other side, though. Like, if you are a... woman, I will also raise my hand, but nobody can see me on the podcast. But people, if you want to just be your natural being and not have to shave or not
yeah,
have to
yeah.
take care of your do or like you want fucking armpit hair, do whatever you want.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's your body hair. It doesn't matter. They make everything seem like yeah, you do.
I don't understand why body hair makes people so uncomfortable.
It does.
Like why
it
some
does.
Why not only body hair because I understand personal body hair making you uncomfortable. But why
oh,
does
yeah,
somebody
yeah.
else's body hair make you uncomfortable?
Because this world's filled with people. Who get uncomfortable buying things other people do all the time. And they can't fathom it. And then the end thing is like, it's so crazy how many people just like can't get over the actions and the ideas and the thought processes of other people sometimes, you know? But
Yeah.
But also, we also like, at least with the body hair thing, it's like, there's all these like stigmas that like exist when you're born into the world that you have no control over.
Yeah.
There's a lot of times where like, people spend like a majority or a portion of their life like unlearning and like realizing, oh, like this is a stigma that exists. Even the same with the weed thing too. It's like,
yeah.
Like people are, and like that's the thing is like, as more time goes on, it seems like, you know, hopefully that future generations will be born to a world where like, there's like less of a stigma around things like that, and it's because the longer it takes you to like to learn that stigmas are wrong, the less time you have to enjoy whatever the good thing is that
yeah.
it is.
Well, it's just also like additional to that. What are like the products that are making money? So whatever commercials are being targeted to you to make you think that like, oh, this is the acceptable lifestyle you should have. This is how you should take care of your beauty. This is what you should do with cosmetics.
Yeah,
blah, blah,
the
blah, blah,
ideal
blah.
Beauty standard.
Yeah.
Just bullshit.
Which is, you know, I think we're definitely making progress
oh,
because 100%. More things, I mean, as far as people's confidence in like body image, in just anything like physical, I think people are becoming more comfortable in their skin.
Mm-hmm.
I totally feel that if people have like had difficulty with it, I get it. But like it's just nice when you like recognize your own personal growth
yeah.
and you see other people and you're just like, oh yeah, you're right. That is awesome. Because you know, what they've taught us in the past is total crap.
You know, I definitely feel that on a personal level. Just because like growing up, I'm a pretty big girl and I love it. I am curvy and I love every single part of me.
Mm-hmm.
And, growing up, I was always taught, you know, like you have to be skinny. Nobody's going to love you if you're not skinny, if you're not this, if you're not that. And my whole life, I was terrified of wearing shorts because I was always told my legs are too fat for me to wear shorts. And I didn't wear shorts again until 2018.
Mm.
I didn't
wow.
wear shorts. Like, literally did not
wow.
even own a pair of shorts. Was terrified of showing my legs.
Mm.
Hated showing my legs.
Mm.
And even now, like, I put something on and I'm like, oh, maybe I shouldn't wear this. And I'm like, no. Like, I feel comfortable. I feel great. Why am I going to stop myself because of, you know, what I was told as a little kid.
Yes.
And, like, it's crazy because back then, like, all of my cousins and everybody in my family was all skinny and everything. And, like, now that everybody is, you know, life happens, everybody is has gained a little bit of weight, and they are all, like, hating their bodies, I have learned to love my body because I've lived with it my whole life, and I'm at a point where I'm so comfortable with myself that I don't give a fuck what anybody says. Like, I, like, my family would be like, oh, I gained a little weight, and I'm like, I know, and it went to all the right places. Great! Yeah. It looks amazing!
I'm so happy to hear that. That sounds great. No, I definitely struggled with self-love or self-image. It's fucking, isn't it crazy to say, honestly, like, say and be like, yes, I, this is hard.
And even
why
with,
should this
you
be
know,
so hard?
Even with as far as you've come and as confident as you are, you still struggle with it. Like, on
right.
a daily basis.
The insecurities.
Yeah. Like, no matter what, you're always going to have, like, that self-doubt, that insecurity, like you're saying, like, it's always going to be there, but, like, you know,
I
feel like a badass bitch.
For sure. I do feel like it is definitely a little bit more pressure on women.
Oh, for sure.
Being like, yeah, whatever, you have to fit into whatever this box is.
Yeah.
Also, where, like, you know, they give you this BS because, like, oh, you're Middle Eastern, so you have these problems, you have to do, like, this thing, whatever. Like, when they tie it to culture, or, I mean, in, you know, I've been out of school for a while, so I'm, you know, assuming there's still bullying going on, which actually... Sorry, this is me having a high brain, but, like, since things have been virtual recently because of the pandemic or hybrid, I actually don't... I am curious what, like, how is bullying minimized, I guess, in school settings. But definitely when, like, I went to school, it was just like, yeah, you felt even worse about it because...
I feel like bullying might be even worse now because of social media.
Yeah.
Oh, well, sure.
It evolves.
Yeah. Exactly. Like,
dude,
back then,
bullies,
there were, you know,
true.
Physical bullying where, you know, you would get picked on, things like that. And, like,
but
now...
But girls were always verbal. I never had anything...
Physical.
Physical,
yeah.
They were always
verbal.
Which I feel like hurt more.
Oh, for sure. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but these words are really going to hurt me, too.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I definitely think, you know, that just transitioned. It evolved into being online now.
Yeah.
But it's definitely still going on.
Gentler and kinder
yeah.
to people. Also, to embrace that, like, oh, hey, you come from this different culture, and, like, this is why your skin's this way. You're like, hey, yeah, that, I understand why your hair is thicker or coarser. Like, I understand why you're, you know... Also, you just, like, people...
I do definitely think, like, the younger generation is a lot more accepting.
Mm-hmm.
And they are more open because of the technology and the visibility that they have...
Mm-hmm.
At their fingertips.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like us growing up, like, yeah, there was the news, there was newspapers and stuff like that, but, like, you know, did you really pick up a newspaper to read it when you were a kid?
Mm-hmm.
No. But now, you got, like, 6-year-olds with iPads, with telephones, and... Telephone. God, I sounded so old saying that.
Benjamin just nodded. We're
like,
no,
yes,
it's telephone.
Telephone, oh, yes.
No one says that. Landline.
Corded devices. Yeah.
But yeah, like, now that everybody has these things at their fingertips, like, they are, you know, more, they're seeing more of the world, they're experiencing more of it, and it's opening their minds more. So I feel like, you know,
yes.
the younger generation, although there are, you know, some people who are very stuck in their ways and things like that and are pretty racist and, like, they perpetuate that through their children and stuff. Like, although there is that, I feel like there's a lot more acceptance going on.
Yes.
And there's a lot more evolution. And it's crazy to think that we're still having a lot of the conversations that we were having 60, 70 years ago.
Yeah.
But we've come so far since then. Even though we're still talking about the same topics, we have... crazily evolved.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's still a lot to be done in the
yeah.
world and everything, and, you know, in acceptance, because the world's pretty ugly.
which is why it's important to just be kind to people. Be gentle with them. Be
everybody
like,
should just
you
smoke
know.
Weed. And,
like, it's great.
Right.
Right.
You just love everybody after that.
Yeah. But like, hasn't that always been the issue, though? It's like there are people who make money off of like violence and wars, and it's like, what is the opposition to that? The people who want peace, love, and smoking weed, you know?
Exactly.
So, yeah, so we know, we see you. But I think that's why like the thing you were saying before about like younger people having access to like the news, but also like the history too. And like also, I feel like kids now are not like told, like, I feel like when we were younger, there was this notion of like, oh, you have to like protect kids by not like having them be like really know about the things that go on in the world. You know, even with something like 9/11, I feel like there was like still like a little bit of the kid glove thing where it's like, we can't tell you nothing happened because you know that
we
something
literally
happened.
Saw it happening.
Right, exactly. Right.
Like,
if they had made us not see it, they would have, you know?
We saw the second plane hit.
Right.
Like,
yeah, I think when the Challenger exploded, it was like kind of a similar thing where it's like immediately kids are just like, they're just like, wait, this is not something that I've ever been like before. What is going on right now? And I think between COVID and Black Lives Matter and George Floyd, like all these things that like, have happened just in the last like 2 years or so, I think that's something kids are like, all right, well, like, because I have friends who are teachers who will talk about how like after things like that, like especially history teachers, they like to have like discussions because kids don't want to be treated like they're stupid, and they never have, and so. If you try acting like something is like not a big deal when they know it is because they're not stupid, they're gonna want to know, and kids definitely are more inclined now to like know and be informed at a younger age for the most part. Again, like at the end of the day, it's all about like whatever influences you have.
Yeah.
Whoever's influencing you is and at a young age is going to have an influence over what you think and say anyway.
Yeah,
so.
Sure. But the absorption rate is different. Like how much they're taking in, and like you said, also they have the power now to go on any device or any source that they have to also find out many perspectives on the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
You're not even getting one source of information anymore.
Yeah.
You're getting it from all sorts of places. Like so many people, so many more people have a voice because of social media platforms where it's like, now I get to tell you what I think firsthand. Like, this is my side of the story and, you know, whatever it is. So I think it's also, it's very, very cool in that like there's obviously good and bad with it. But I do think it's very cool for people to be connected and for people to you know, organize a force and be just stronger with each other because you can be like, oh, I also to know that you're not alone. You're like, hey, you know, may think you're going through something in your own town, but it's just like, no, the same thing's happening over there.
Yeah.
Or like
yeah.
same thing happening the next day, blah, 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 blah. And it's just like, connect with each other because you are stronger together. You are like, you know, it's the people where, you know, we're the ones who create change. So
it's definitely made the world so much smaller.
Holy shit.
True. Mm.
It's crazy. It's crazy to think about it. That like, it's so easy to just take out my, I can get on WhatsApp right now and call somebody that is like 10,000 miles away.
Yeah.
That's insane.
Yeah. Before they have to like
get cards,
yeah.
a little card and like dial a specific number and then. Like, even though it said 2 hours, sometimes it was only, like, 30 minutes. I remember those days. Like, shit.
I know that probably carrier pigeons are very well trained, but I'm like, you don't really trust that they have an important message, and they're like, I'm going to tie this to a bird, and this
how
bird will
they
deliver.
Know where to go?
Yeah. Sexting must have taken so long to do it, because you have to wait for the birds to go, and then come back, and... Yeah, I mean, I guess like bird. I know nothing about pigeons. I'm not gonna pretend like I know nothing about carrier pigeons. But
you watch Game of Thrones.
I do watch Game of Thrones. They do use carrier pigeons.
You know,
so.
But pigeons. What if they've just gotten dumber over centuries? Because I walk around New York City and I'm just like, this thing can't deliver a message.
Well,
because
they don't use it for
this
messages
so
anymore.
Yeah, you're right.
They
so say
that.
Yeah,
they escalated.
Yeah, you're right. They're like, now I can't sharpen these skills anymore. I'm just going to walk around. And to get
this friend. Yeah, man, you can go up to them and be like, hey, can you deliver this? They're like, what am I, like, grandpa? I don't know. They deliver that for you? I don't know where to go.
Who still writes letters? Send them an email.
Yeah. Oh, God.
That pigeon's got a Gmail. Yeah.
Well, Gabby, this has been an absolute pleasure. Before we close out, do you want to throw any more capital cities that you got on your mind? No pressure to do it. Just if there's any that have called to you.
Keep forgetting about that.
Yeah.
Is Denver? Is that a capital? Probably
let's see.
I know that it, AC.
No, you know, it is hard because, like, in theory, you'd think, like, the most popular city, and this is the hard thing about learning the capital cities in school, too, is, like, you'd be like, oh, the city that I know is going to be the capital of the state, and that's not the case.
That is correct.
Denver?
Yes!
Capital.
Yes.
Cool.
All right, cool.
In this case, it is, though. So, well
and then
done.
I want to say, like, Atlanta for Georgia, but I know it's not. Or is it?
Do you? Let's see.
I don't think so.
Well, yeah. Following a vote in 1868, mm-hmm. Georgia once again had a new state capital, Atlanta.
Wow, look at you.
Yeah, that's
okay.
A capital.
All right.
Ninth largest metropolitan area.
Is Austin the capital of Texas?
I think it might be.
I love how we have to check this.
Yeah,
don't
that's why I get
challenges
to people, so that way we don't have
we
to
don't
do that.
Know.
If you guys ask me to name every state, I can name every
state.
Yeah.
Austin is, yes.
All oh, okay, right. All right. I don't know how many that is, but I got them.
your strategy of I'm going to say the thing and be like, nah, it's definitely not. It has been working out very well for you.
Nice.
For that three, so.
What's your total?
Right now we are at 5 state capitals.
Ooh, okay,
yeah.
All
yeah.
Right.
Yep. Yeah.
45 to go.
That's right.
yeah, honestly, I think
you feel solid with that number?
That's a great number.
Five
it
is. Number.
It
five.
Is.
It's a whole hand. It's a
it's
whole,
a whole hand.
Hand.
Well, we give you a hand, so thank you for coming on to the
thank
show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
We talked about your stuff, and we're so excited to dive into it, and thank you again for bringing all this stuff. Please plug away all the things you're doing,
yeah,
any handles,
thoughts.
Any thoughts that you have.
Yeah, follow me on Instagram, at Gabby's Gourmet Goodies, LLC. I am going to be having 2 events coming up this month. I have a smoke and shop on the 19th. It's going to be in Jersey City. If you go on my Instagram, the link is in my bio. It's a free event. A lot of edibles are going to be there. There's going to be a lot of good flour, good people, good music. And then I'm also going to be doing another event on the 24th, which is the Wednesday right before Thanksgiving. And I'm going to be doing a Thanksgiving themed menu for that one.
Oh, man.
So definitely keep an eye out on my Instagram. All the information is going to be on there. And yeah. It was great having
me
here. Thank you, guys.
Everyone, go eat your food.